We are live on YouTube.
Yes, we are live.
Okay.
Recording so start.
Recording also started.
Yeah.
Okay. Good to go, sir.
Yes.
Okay. Fine. So, thank you all for joining us today. I am Rita Jangam, the product manager for Merrill Hernia Solutions. Welcome you all for a very interesting webinar today on troubleshooting in hernia. In collaboration with Chennai Hernia Society and our esteemed speakers and panelists today, it brings us immense pride to conduct this event today with all of you. Before we move on, I would like to have certain housekeeping announcements. Kindly put your phone or laptop on mute. We will be taking the questions at the end, towards the end of the webinar. So kindly post your questions in the chat window and we will take up all the questions at the end after the panel discussion is over. So before we start the webinar, I would like to introduce Dr. Naveen Alexander, and sir would like to address everyone. So over to you, Naveen, sir.
Hi guys, it's a pleasure to be here with all of y'all. And Dr. Prem Kumar, Dr. Deepak and I, from the Chennai Hernia Society, which is around 200 members strong. And it's a very small group right now, but this is almost our fourth webinar that we're having, not webinar as such. We've done a few live meetings too, and now we moved on to webinars because of the current situation. It's a real pleasure to meet up with the Merrill people here who have kindly condescended to do this for us. Dr. Deepak is stuck in an emergency right now, so he will be joining us a little later. We have a good discussion for you all today. This will be, first we will be discussing primarily on troubleshooting in ventral hernia surgery, laparoscopy, then in inguinal hernia surgery, and from GEM Hospital, Dr. Pinnock will be giving us a talk on mesh infections regarding the prevention of it, as well as what we should do when we have an infection. Moving on, we will be having a panel discussion with case scenarios. We have esteemed panelists here, Dr. Narayanan, who's a professor of Sri Ramachandra Medical College, Dr. Ashwin, a very good laparoscopic hernia surgeon from Ashwin Hospital in Coimbatore, Dr. Bharat from the GEM branch in Coimbatore, who will be with us, and along with him, Dr. Pari. So the questions that you will be asking in the chat box, if relevant to the panel discussion, we can take it up directly there itself. Okay, right? So moving on, I would like to invite Dr. Balachandran Prem Kumar to give us the first talk on troubleshooting in ventral hernia surgery.
Hi, everyone. Sorry, I apologize. I joined a little bit late. I was stuck up with a small emergency. Thanks, Naveen, for taking up that role and doing it in the last minute. We'll go ahead with the presentations, and we'll go ahead. I'll see you guys at the panel discussion. Thank you.
So before I think Prem sir starts, I would like to introduce Prem sir formally to the webinar. So just to introduce Dr. Prem sir. Prem sir is a senior consultant and of minimal access bariatric and robotic surgeon at Apollo Hospitals, Chennai. Sir is one of the pioneers of single incision laparoscopy in the country. He has also performed first single incision inguinal hernia repair in the country. He was also a team member who performed first robotic bariatric sleeve gastrectomy and gastric bypass and Sills gastric bypass in the country. He has bagged many prestigious awards in the industry and is also an active member of many surgical societies across the country. So over to you, Prem sir.
Thank you very much for that nice introduction, and I'd like to thank the Merrill team, and I'm also happy that the Chennai Hernia Society could collaborate with you to have this program today. It's interesting that we are doing troubleshooting in ventral hernia surgery, you know, because we wanted to do something different rather than, you know, just take the routine tap and tip and things like that. So we are going through a problem-based approach. So basically, okay, so these are the issues that I will be dealing with today. See, first of all, case selection, port placements, closure of defects, issues with mesh placement, and complications However, I will not be covering mesh infections because I think Dr. Pinnock is going to, you know, take that up as a completely separate topic. So now going on to case selection. See, basically, what we say is prevention is better than cure. Okay, so in any case, rather than trying to get into a problem, if we select ideal cases for the surgery, then we can, you know, try to, you know, overcome most of the unwanted complications. So what are the cases that you would not like to take up for your ventral hernias? Well, number one, morbidly obese people, those people who have respiratory compromise, who are going to have respiratory issues following the operation, which will lead to, you know, increased intra-abdominal pressure, thereby causing a more chance for recurrence, etc. Multiple previous surgeries, even in the best of hands, even a second or a third operation can be difficult, particularly laparoscopically. So you will have to keep that in mind when you are taking up a patient for laparoscopic ventral hernia surgery. Loss of domain is another very important issue. By loss of domain, we mean that, you know, the hernia sac volume is more than the abdominal cavity volume, or that the hernia is so large that when you reduce the contents, it can cause an intra-abdominal compartment syndrome and respiratory issues. So when you are trying to do such surgeries by laparoscopy, definitely you will encounter a lot of issues. Next thing is technical expertise. Yes, always try to do procedures that you are, you know, well trained in and what you are confident doing. So if you are an IPOM person and you want to move into an IPOM plus, I would suggest that, you know, you have somebody to help you out who's got some experience. And if you want to move on from IPOM plus to AWRs, ETEPs, etc., you know, don't try to experiment or go to
I think Prem sir went into mute.
Prem sir, you are on mute.
Prem sir. Hello, Prem sir.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah, we can hear you, sir.
Okay. See, somebody from the host unmuted me. I'm really sorry about that.
So you were in technical expertise. So we do not want to, you know, go around and mess around with the patient. So always when you are going in to do a more complicated procedure and you are trying to, you know, learn a new procedure, always have some expert help. Now going on to port placement. See, the issue about ventral hernias is that not all ventral hernias are going to be in the same place. Like, for example, if you're doing a gallbladder, you know where the gallbladder is positioned in the abdomen. So your port placement is pretty standard. If you're going to do a right inguinal hernia, you know how to place your ports. If you're going to do a left inguinal hernia, you know how to place your ports. And unfortunately, in a ventral hernia, you know, sometimes the hernia could be in the epigastrium. Sometimes it could be the left iliac region. Sometimes it could be the right iliac region. So how are you going to place your ports? And you can have issues arising with port placement. So if you look at this picture here, you can see the different quadrants of the abdomen. So as a rule, your three primary ports, by three primary ports, I mean your telescopic port, your right hand working port, and your left hand working port, as a rule, never ever place any more than one primary port in a particular quadrant. Okay. So you can put accessory ports there, but your primary port should be in separate quadrants so that it doesn't cross overcrowding of your ports. Now I'll just quickly rush through some basic principles. It's not going to be too exhausting. Just one or two slides about, you know, the ergonomics so that you can have an idea so that you don't get into wrong port placement. The first thing is you have to maintain certain important angles. The first one is the azimuth angle, which is the angle between your optic axis to your working port. Okay. And the ideal azimuth angle is 30 degrees, as you can see in this picture. And I put this picture because, you know, this knife and fork, because eating is the most ergonomic thing that we do. You sit down, you look into your plate and you eat with your right and left hand. So that makes it very convenient to do. Similarly, your manipulation angle, that is, if the azimuth angle is equal on both sides, you will have a double azimuth angle, which is your manipulation angle, which is the angle between your two working ports, that is 60 degrees. So how do you get these, to get these kind of angles together? Basically, you have to have a triangulation of your ports. And your target organ, the target organ for us is going to be your corneal sac. That should be in the middle of the optic axis, and your right and left hand ports, that is your primary working ports, should be on either side with the telescope in the center, which is called as on-axis viewing. Another important, so that if you do all these things, you will not have a needling of instruments and you will not have any, you know, close port placement and issues with that. Another important thing is inline positioning. By inline positioning, I mean the surgeon, the target organ, that is your hernial sac, and the monitor all should be in the same line. And by doing this, what you're doing is you're actually making your visual axis where you're looking and your motor axis where you're operating both in the same line of alignment. So your visual axis and your motor axis should be in the same plane. Okay. So if you see this picture, you will see the hernial sac in the center. The defect is an umbilical hernia. You can see number one, that is your camera port, and the hernial defect is right in the center of the optic axis. And you have your right and left, which are your main working ports, on either side. And you've got enough distance between the hernial defect and your port so that you can operate and you can, you know, have a free space and enough area to play around with your ports. So actually, if you see this video, you will see that is the hernial defect there. What we normally do is, before the operation, we desufflate the abdomen and we mark the mesh all around. The size of the mesh that we are going to be placed is marked all around. And the standard is you should have a minimum of at least 5 centimeters around all sides of the external part of the hernial defect, not from the center, from the borders of the hernial defect, at least 5 centimeters all around. So once you desufflate, you mark 5 centimeters and you add plus 1 centimeter so that when you take your mesh from inside, you will not have any crumpling of the mesh. And if you see the ports, that is the camera port and right and left hand working port. And I've got enough space all around, you know, so that I can use the trackers. I can use the trackers and I can dissect all around. And I will be standing on this side and the monitor will be opposite on this side. So that will be the ideal way of port placement. And always when you are dissecting, it is always good to take off this fatty apron there, because as you know, your trackers have only around 3 to 4 millimeters of play. And if you are to tack it on the fat, the chance of that falling down later will be, you know, it's quite possible. So these are the corner, you know, transfacial sutures. And actually, I will be showing this in more detail in my next video. I just wanted to show this so that, you know, I can play the port placement for you. Another very important thing and a very controversial topic is defect closure. Should you close the defect or not? See, there are a lot of schools of thought on this. Small umbilical hernias, maybe, you know, like a 0.5 centimeter or 1 centimeter defect, you really may not need to close those defects. But larger defects definitely have to be closed, because whatever said and done, you know, the abdominal wall also, you know, maintains the equilibrium. It also helps in accessory respiration. And, you know, it also helps to keep your spine stability, etc. So the larger these defects, each time you respire and as years pass by, the chances of these hernial defects getting larger are very possible. So if you can close these defects properly, by all means, please go and close them. Because if you don't, then, you know, an issue like this can happen. Can you see what's happening here? You can actually see the defect. Probably it wasn't closed and probably a large mesh enough was not placed. And you can see that the hernia itself has got the mesh inside. As you can see, the trackers and the mesh inside the hernial defect. Another important issue is that if you want to, you know, close the defect, it has to be closed well. And closing off defects in the anterior abdominal wall is not as easy as we think, because the abdominal wall is under pressure. There will be pneumoperitoneum. I mean, try to take bites. These bites can actually break through. You actually close such large defects. Okay. So whenever you want to close large defects and divarications, etc., you got to take serial continuous bites. As you can see that I'm doing here, this is actually a divarication closure that is being done. Just pull it gently. If you have barbed sutures, they are ideal to be used, so that, you know, they can help you to maintain your traction. And once you take a couple of bites, as you can see here, multiple bites are taken. The sutures are gradually tightened. Now, pneumoperitoneum is deflated to a lower pneumo, as you can see here. And all the sutures are serially, you know, pulled so that the entire suture can become tight and the suture does not break through and you have a good tightness. So same principle can be applied, you know, even to off your hernia defects, etc. Now, another important thing is mesh, place the mesh and you anchor it. You find that, you know, about, you know, and you have issues where you cannot pass the mesh because most of the IPAR meshes are composite meshes. That is to, you know, bilayered meshes, and trying to, you know, pass it into the trocar may cause issues. And while passing the mesh through the trocar, you can develop problems. So what do you do? This is a slightly old video. I really apologize for the quality. So what we normally do is, you know, every composite mesh has got two layers. So it has got one layer which faces the the abdominal wall and one layer which faces the viscera. Now the layer which faces the viscera actually is the more, you know, delicate layer. And what you have to do is you'll have to roll the mesh in such a way that the layer which is supposed to face the viscera is actually rolled inwards, so that once you pass it through the defect, it, you know, it does not get traumatized and that delicate layer, you know, this, does not get damaged. Depending on whichever company you are buying, the material may differ. Okay, so I'm rolling it inward so that I can pass it through. And ideally, if you can have a 12 millimeter trocar, you can pass it through that. Or if you have a 12 mm, you can remove the flange and you can pass it through. Now you can see that I am doing the marking all around after desuffrating the abdomen. And these are the transfacial sutures. See, once you mark the mesh, once you map the mesh outside and you mark the transfacial sutures, you initially pull up these transfacial sutures, then the mesh automatically comes up and you will have an equidistant placement. And after that, you can, you know, you can use your tackers and you apply your double crown of tackers. The double crown is the outer crown, which I'm putting now, and the inner crown, which is facing just around the hernial defect. So that is the inner crown, which I'm placing there, as you can see. Okay. Now I'm just going on to some interesting complications that one can face and what do we do in these situations. Not all these videos are mine. I have acknowledged the contributors of these videos. That is Dr. Anmol. This is a video which shows as you can see here, the port is being inserted. You can see the hernial defect there with the bowel going through. Trocar is being placed. And you notice that the bowel has been injured over there. There's a tear in the bowel with the exposure of the mucosa, as you can see there. There you can see there's a nice bowel injury there. So in this case, the bowel injury was closed laparoscopically itself. And however, the mesh repair was the corneal repair was not continued with. The patient was again sent back to the ward and was taken up after 10 days for the hernia operation. This is another video by the same author. As you can see, there's dense adhesions there. You have to be extremely cautious in your, when you have multiple surgeries, like I mentioned before, you know, because if you cause any issues, you know, like visceral injury, etc., then, you know, you may have to abandon the procedure. So as you see here, dissection is being done. The hernial defect has been reduced. And as they're dissecting towards the liver area there, you notice that the gallbladder has been opened. You see the bile there and you see the opening in the gallbladder. So that here also similarly, the gallbladder was just, the perforation was closed and this patient was taken up after a couple of days. This is a patient who has undergone ETEP repair, you know, abdominal wall reconstruction. As you can see, the entire large spleen mesh is there. See, the hernial content is being reduced. All the bowel has actually gone completely into the posterior rectus sheath. This is due to a dehiscence of the posterior rectus sheath. That's why we always mention never ever, you know, suture anything under tension, because postoperatively, once the patient starts breathing, these sutures are bound to give way and can result in a very big mess like this. And trying to, you know, rectify these operations is not a joke, and it can be extremely difficult because an E-TEPT-R by itself is a massive operation, and we have large meshes which are being placed. You know, large meshes, almost like 30 into 30 centimeters meshes will be placed, and trying to, you know, rectify all these things. If that mesh gets infected, etc., it can be a real pain. This is a interesting case by Dr. Vlad from Russia. As you can see, this is the initial operation where the mesh has been placed. Then subsequently, I think, you know, the patient has had some issues where 700 ml of blood had come from the drain. So he went in again, and you can see the huge hematoma there, you know, which has gone and sucked out, and he has put multiple drains, and which one should not take lightly, you know, because these are major operations by themselves. And as in any operation, complications are bound to happen, but one should try to, you know, be aware of the possibilities and try to avoid these complications from happening. This is one of videos of my own. A patient had a corneal defect through a fan and steel scar. So I am dissecting, as you can see here, there's plenty of adhesions there. You can see that's the corneal defect there. So I'm trying to, you know, take down the peritoneum so that I can place the mesh, you know, below the level of the pubic bone. Okay. That is a small, and you see, there is a small opening there, which I was not aware of initially. Then when I went in, I noticed, I could see that, you know, I could see the Foley's bulb through there, which you'll be seeing soon. So that actually is the rent in the bladder. So you can see the Foley's bulb inside there. So here a primary repair, a double layered repair. And as there was no spillage, and this is not the, you know, like bowel. So after a double layered repair, I went ahead and completed the, you know, the mesh repair. So these are just some interesting videos which I wanted to show you. And I think, you know, I'm done with my presentation here. And definitely, like they were saying, I think we're going to be taking questions at the end of the.
Yes, sir. We will take the questions at the end.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Next talk will be by Professor Naveen Alexander. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, so before I think Naveen sir starts, I would like to formally introduce him. So Naveen sir is a professor of general surgery and a senior consultant laparoscopic, bariatric and general surgeon at Sri Ramachandra Medical College, which we fondly known as SRMC, Chennai. Along with holding prestigious educational degrees, sir has also published many papers and write-ups in several journals across the country and internationally. He's a passionate teacher and is also a faculty for many healthcare MNCs as well as different medical colleges. So over to you, Naveen sir. It's an honor to have you with us today.
Thank you so much, Amrita. I will start my talk now. Dr. Deepak is in the waiting room. I can see that. Can you just admit him?
Yeah. I will admit him, sir.
Yes. So my talk is going to be a little more basic than Dr. Prem sir's. Okay, this is because laparoinguinal surgery is a little more dangerous area than compared to doing a straightforward IPOM, I feel. So there's a lot of things that can go wrong in a fairly simple surgery. So, so basically, if you look at the stats behind hernia surgery, inguinal surgery, the men it's around 43% lifelong risk. In women, it's very much less, around 6%. The basic difference between that is there are much more complications in men compared to women too. And if you look at the professional societies which have guidelines for the treatment of inguinal hernias, until now, we still don't have a consensus on what is the best kind of treatment modality for an inguinal hernia. As of now, the one which has the lowest recurrence rate still is a Liechtenstein the world over. But as you can see, many centers which are performing laparoscopy surgery for the last 20 to 25 years, definitely the recurrence acceptance rate in these centers has become much less than what it is for a standard like Einstein. Unfortunately, all our centers, whether they are old, young, whatever, we have what is known as a learning curve, and this always has significant implications. So basically, moving on to the complications of an inguinal hernia surgery in laparoscopy, you can have perioperative problems, early postoperative problems, and late problems. Late problems usually result with mesh infections, recurrences, and I'm not going to be talking about that. We are going to be covering more of perioperative and early postoperative problems here. Okay, so in perioperative, we're going to be looking at general anesthesia and laparoscopic, general laparoscopic problems, vascular injuries, nerve injuries, visceral, as well as cord injuries. So moving on straight away into starting the surgery. Your patient is on the table. You've decided you're going to go ahead with the TAPP. If you look at it, the Cochrane review, which was last published in 2015, comparing open entry versus a closed entry for a TAPP, there is no statistical difference in the rate of any kind of injury. And this is pretty much consistent with any kind of laparoscopic surgery that exists. There is no difference between an open technique of entry versus a varus. So the basic concept is whatever you have learned, stick with it. You should not be having major complications. If you look at the rate of major entry injuries, it's between 1 and 8 injuries for every 1,000 attempts. And here is a video I've taken from YouTube. It's a very interesting video. So this is a very skinny patient who has a 1 centimeter umbilical hernia, but she is undergoing a procedure for an inguinal hernia. Okay, so the surgeon has decided to go through the umbilical hernia and insert the first trocar. So he has entered into the abdomen here and has proceeded to create the peritoneal flaps for a TAPP. While just looking around, he sees there is a huge hematoma present in the retroperitoneal area. So he has decided to go ahead and check what that is. And as you can see, it's a huge hematoma. The patient's BP has been dropping, and careful exploration of that without disturbing it too much, the patient, the surgeon has realized that there is a small injury onto the iliac vessels here, probably. And what he claims in that video, it's possibly due to a scalpel injury itself by the entry, not even by the trocar. So that is something that I learned. A scalpel injury itself can cause a problem when you are entering into a skinny person. Now, this is a case of mine, very recent one. This patient had, we were planning for a bilateral TAPP, but the anesthesia was a little, the abdomen was a little tight, and I had to use quite a bit of force to enter. I'm always a proponent of open entry. And when I entered, I found this. There was some amount of blood collection there. So I went ahead and explored it. And I could see, to my horror, there was a bit of a mesenteric injury. It wasn't anything very significant, but definitely it works on the patient surgeon's confidence level. That means even after a few thousand of cases of laparoscopy, you still are prone to having such problems like this. So if you identify a problem like that, take care of it immediately. Entry injury in TEP is not so much due to trocars, because we are placing them bluntly. But the one thing that can cause a problem is if you tend to use a dissecting balloon. And this dissecting balloon has very several uncommon but highly troublesome complications. If the patient has had a balloon inserted and excessive pressure has been given into the balloon, then you can have a shearing of the inferior epigastric vessels. It can result in a huge hematoma, which might, you know, immediately you might have taken care of it, but postoperatively the patient continues to bleed. So the recommendation in most centers which do use a balloon is to do a certain amount of finger dissection and then insert the balloon and then increase the pressure. So this is a case where you will see that I have gone for a TEP and I have found that there is a small opening in the peritoneum due to my secondary trocar insertion. Now, in this case, since it was in an area which I could not access for a good suturing, I prefer this. I happen to put in a 5 mm trocar into the Palmer's point and reduce the pneumoperitoneum and proceeded with the rest of the TEP surgery. Now, this is another case of a pneumoperitoneum happening due to dissection. Okay, as you can see, the pneumo is hindering my vision right now. And on careful exploration, you can see there is a small hole there. This small hole can turn out to be a much larger one due to our manipulation. But before anything could happen very significantly in this patient, I have tackled it by using a straightforward endo loop in this case. So if it's a small one and if you are able to grasp the edges of the rent that you have created, all you need to do is to put an endo loop and you can get away with handling the rent. Sometimes these rents are tend to be a little larger due to excessive traction on the peritoneum. As you can see, there's a large hole here. Now that's not going to be settling down with just an endo loop. You need to do a formal closure if you want to continue to do a TEP. The other option is, if this is creating a lot of problems intraoperatively during the surgery, the second option is to convert it from a TEP into a TAPP. Of course, to explain to the patient postoperatively that the ports have been changed is going to be a bit of a problem, but it is the correct thing to do. So one more problem that we will be facing is when you are doing a TEP is to decide whether you would like to use midline versus triangular ports. The current consensus is, if you are planning for a bilateral TEP, midline or triangular is good enough. But if you're planning to do a unilateral TEP, preferably midline is better. Triangular does not, you know, the triangulation is not so great for just a unilateral port placement. Next thing we're moving on to is bowel injury. And this usually happens when we are dealing with a TAPP only and patient has had some previous kind of surgeries before. Or the second thing is when you have bowel present in the hernial sac and you have not reduced it in a proper manner. This could be because the bowel is very densely adherent. This could be due to the chronicity of the hernia. It's a long-standing hernia, previous pelvic surgery, or if there is a previous mesh. Okay, so these are all factors that play a role in possibility of bowel injury. Second thing, and more commonly, is excessive traction on incarcerated bowel. And this is always seen both in TAP and when, you know, if you're having a TEP and you're pulling down the sac with excessive traction, you might be holding the bowel within your forceps and causing a injury. The other thing that can happen is a thermal injury, usually seen after TEP, when you've not seen the bowel, but you use cautery to reduce the sac, then there's a possibility of a delayed presentation of a thermal injury. This usually results in a perforation 8 to 10 days after the primary surgery. If you've identified the bowel injury intraoperatively, the surgeon makes a call on these patients whether he wants to progress with the surgery or not. Most of the time, we end up closing the defect, closing the bowel injury. And then what happens is, if there is no contamination, you take a risk and go ahead with a mesh repair. Second option, you think there is mild contamination or you don't want to take the risk if there is no contamination, the option of an open hernia repair is always there. Whether to put a mesh or do a primary repair is up to the surgeon. Third option, close the bowel and then come back later for a proper formal hernia repair. As Dr. Prem has already talked to us about bladder injury, here it's a little more common as compared to ventral hernias because we are in this area all the time. So it can be either an extraperitoneal bladder injury or an intraperitoneal bladder injury. So if you look at it, there has been many papers based on this. You have one from Bruce Ramshaw, which came out way back in the early 2000s. and also one from Crocker Link, which came out in the early 2010s. Crocker Link's paper shows that bladder injury can happen in almost 1 per 650 cases of inguinal hernia repairs. So in TEP, one of the main causes of bladder injury is if you direct your port downwards, the dissecting balloon port downwards, and then create the pressure, if there's a chance there is excessive pressure on the bladder resulting in a rupture, which might not be picked up on the spot. It might be picked up a little later on. Second thing is, if the placement of the trocars, which are used for working of the hernia surgery, is lower and not placed under direct visualization, that can also cause a bladder injury. Okay, so between to whether the patient should be catheterized or not is also a big discussion. We have found that in many studies that catheterization of the patients always ends up with more retention post removal of the catheter in the post-op period. But if the injury has occurred, we have no other option. So extraperitoneal injuries, always we'll have to drain it with a catheter. Intraperitoneal bladder injuries definitely require a surgical drainage, a surgical repair. This has to be done in two layers, as Dr. Prem already said. And you might have to place a closed suction drain in the preperitoneal space. Mesh placement following bladder injury is still possible because the urine is usually not colonized, and usually if the patient does not have any active urinary infection. Following bladder repair, a cystogram has to be performed in 2 weeks to evaluate for an ongoing leak. So this is a case from earlier in my career where excessive, excuse me, please, 1 second. This is earlier in my career, and this was when I had just moved from a TAPP to a TEP. And I found that this is, I think, my second case of a TEP, and excessive movement of my dissecting hands. Here I found a nice, perfectly centered bladder injury. I was lucky to get away with the closure in this patient, but I was not so brave at that point to keep a mesh. I went ahead with a bilateral open hernia repair in this patient. So vascular injury is one of the commonest injuries in lap hernia surgery, and it's often a reason for conversion. This can happen from the time we put in a trocar. That could be a rectus muscle vessel injury, inferior epigastric vessel injury, anytime from the peritoneal, preperitoneal space dissection until the time you put in a mesh, inferior epigastric vessels can get injured. If you're playing around too much on the pubic symphysis, trying to create a nice plane for you to put your stitches or your tackers, then the venous plexus might bleed. If you've not picked up an aberrant obturator vein, that's a possibility it might get damaged. And when you're doing your cord dissection, testicular vessel injury is a very easy possibility. The biggest problem that you could have here is when you have excessive, when you have a large sac or you have a femoral sac, and you're not sure too much about the anatomy, and then you go and play around with the iliac vessels, resulting in a iliac vessel injury. So I'm going to be showing you a few videos of different parts of this. Before that, just reviewing our anatomy. You've all heard of the corona mortis. There is another thing that is visible here, is the Ben David circle. This is a network of veins that you can see. The on your right over here is the iliac vessels, and or sitting on top of the blood on the Cooper's ligament is the Ben David circle, is a network of veins. And you have what is known as the corona mortis, as you very well know. I'm not going to go too much into this, but basically when you have an obturator artery aberrant connection between the external iliac and the obturator, that's called the corona mortis. And this, sorry. So this is when you're dealing with a femoral hernia, your vessels are going to be very, very close to each other next to the hernial defect itself. Naturally, that's how the anatomy is. So your reduction of the hernia also needs to be very careful. Also, you need who's decided that that femoral hernia, once you've reduced it, needs a closure, then your closure needs to be from side to side rather than from top to bottom. From top to bottom, it's going to cause, there is more chance of an injury to the vessels. A side to side closure from the 3 o'clock to the 9 o'clock position is always better. Similarly, in obturator hernias, here you will find it below the pubic bone. As you can see, there are a lot of leash of vessels over here. Closure of this defect is not recommended. Just the mesh placement of the entire myopectinal orifice is recommended. Okay. So vascular injury management, if the patient has an inferior epigastric injury, it has to be identified, observed, and if you think it's not going to settle down, then you clip or you ligate. Second option is to use a bipolar forceps and handle it. Corona mortis, how do you avoid it? Do not
So I think there's some network issue. Probably we should just go with the next lecture till Dr. joins.
Yeah, I think there's some network issue there with. Can you hear me, Ashwin, clearly?
I can hear you. We can hear you. I think Dr. Naveen has dropped out.
Yeah. I'll come back.
Okay.
What happened? Naveen,
how many more slides do you have?
I have another few more, just 5 or 6 more.
No, I think there were some connectivity issues from your end. You can share it now.
Yeah, I'll
share
your
screen and probably finish it quickly. We are pretty late, actually.
Sorry.
Probably the host privileges were taken up.
Is this visible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it is visible now.
Yeah, okay. I'll just move on and finish this. So this is a small clipping of an inferior epigastric injury, where here you can identify that there is a lateral injury to the vessel. All it needed was a small buzz on the vessel per se. Here is a more drastic video. This is from another surgeon, where there has been a previous repair done. The mesh has already been removed. And here the surgeon is trying to identify the pubic bone, but unfortunately causes an injury on the external iliac. The internal iliac vein. So he had to do a closure of this, abandon this, and start the patient on heparin. This is an interesting case from the NET, where the patient has had an inferior epigastric injury, which was handled intraoperatively, but postoperatively, the patient developed a huge bulge, pushing the mesh upwards, and then they did a CT and an MRI, and they found that the inferior epigastric artery had undergone a change of a pseudo aneurysm. This is a small video showing you how excessive traction on the sac and the cord can cause problems. As you can see, the instrument itself has bent and there has been an injury to the testicular artery. This has been handled by this surgeon by just using a bipolar forceps. I'm just going to skip this and show you one picture. Yes. So this is how the arrangement of the nerves are in the area, which is the called as the triangle of pain. As you can see, from medial to lateral, we start with the genitofemoral nerve and they branched off very much high up. Okay, so next to that, laterally is the femoral nerve, then you have the lateral cutaneous nerve of thigh. Basically, all of these nerves are covered with a thick pad of fat, and the golden rule right now is that you do not pull down this pad of fat to expose these nerves. If you don't expose them, your chance of having a pain postoperatively is very much less. Post-op, as I was talking to you earlier, urinary retention is a problem in around 2% of the patients. Preoperative catheterization is definitely a risk factor. So the patient is asked to void their bladders before they come into surgery. And post-op swellings, usually it means that there is a seroma. Very rarely it is due to a hematoma. The hematoma is usually because you've not picked up some vessel that you've dissected and not handled it intraoperative. So the way of reducing a pseudosac resulting in a seroma is to identify the pseudosac, in like how you see in this case. And there are two ways of handling this. You pull it down nicely. You can either tack it to the Cooper's ligament or to the anterior abdominal wall, as I have done in this case. So that's a nice way of reducing the chance of a seroma in this patient. Thank you and stay safe.
Thanks, Naveen. That was good. I think we'll move on to the next talk. Amrita?
Yes, sir.
You can introduce Dr. Pinnock.
Yeah. So, to introduce Dr. Pinnock, sir is presently working as a senior consultant in the Department of Minimal Invasive Surgery and Colorectal Surgery, and also leading the Hernia and Abdominal Wall Reconstruction Unit at GEM Hospital, Chennai. He has a vast work experience of over 13 years, working with the leading organizations all over India. So, over to you, Pinnock, sir.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone who have joined us for this webinar today. I thank Chennai Hernia Society and Merrill Academy for organizing this wonderful program. And I bring greetings from GEM Hospital, Chennai. I have been entitled with the talk of mesh infection, prevention versus cure. So if we talk about a match between prevention and cure, the match is lost in the first slide itself. Because prevention always outweighs the measures one takes once infection sets in. So you have done a complicated hernia surgery, and you and your ego goes for a romantic ride. In between, weeks later or a month or even years later, Mr. Bug comes in. And then your ego takes a hit. And then you start to think, why me? Well, mesh infection, yes, it is a big problem. As the patient suffers a lot, the surgeon suffers a lot, your reputation is at stake, and it's a huge financial burden for the patient. If we see laparoscopic ventral hernia surgery, the infection rate is around 3.6%, while in open, it may be as high as up to 10%. Now, prevention. Can we predict which patients are susceptible to infection? Yes, we can. So if we consider the patient factors, like if a patient is an active smoker, uncontrolled diabetes, obesity, advancing age, a high ASA grade. Similarly, hernia factors, which include a recurrent hernia, a larger hernia, hernia done on emergency basis, surgery which is extending too long, or open surgeries have been more susceptible to infection. Similarly, a macroporous polypropylene placed in the vetrorectal space is safest. It's the most safe place to be to prevent mesh infection. Similarly, some pre-existing skin or wound issues, a patient with an existing stoma or an enterocutaneous fistula or an inadvertent enterotomy will place the patient at a higher risk of wound infection. Now, this is a fantastic application which can be downloaded both in your iOS and Android device, which is the CDAR app, which is Carolina's equation for determining associated risk. Now, what it does is, it takes into account the important factors which causes mesh infection, and it predicts the risk and the financial impact of wound-related complication following a ventral hernia repair. So if we see what are the factors included, it's diabetes, whether it's uncontrolled diabetes with a fasting sugar more than 180, if the patient uses tobacco, is it a recurrent hernia repair, is there a possibility of entry into the GI tract or presence of a stoma, is there any active abdominal infection present, or if the patient is planned for a concomitant skin or subcutaneous flap advancement, or if he is due to undergo a component separation, and the BMI of the patient. So this will give an estimate of the possibility of infection as well as the financial burden if infection happens. Now, optimization of modifiable risks. So what are the risks which can optimize beforehand, like asking the patient to quit smoking, control of diabetes, loss of weight, and during surgery, we can apply for strict aseptic techniques. Preferably, it should be the first case, using fresh instruments, choosing minimal invasive surgery, doing a perforator sparing surgery, and when it's an infected environment, choosing a non-synthetic mesh and planning for a delayed primary closure is a better idea. My slides are stuck. Okay, so now you have mesh infection. So now what can you do? So mesh infection can present as early with erythema, tenderness, warmth, and all signs of inflammation. My slides are getting stuck.
Sir, with the mouse cursor, can you click on the slide, please? Is it working?
Yeah. And delayed presentations are like non-healing wound, sinus with intermittent discharge, chronic seroma, or a meshoma. Or it can present with a mesh enteric fistula with the mesh peeping through the wound. And one has to keep in mind that many a times patient presenting with a sinus which is intermittently discharging, but even the CT doesn't reveal any communication with the bowel, 17% of the time there will be some kind of communication. So this is one such case where the patient is a multi-recurrent hernia. She had open surgery, IPOM and everything. And now she presented with a draining sinus which was persisting for 7 years. Now, the CT never revealed any communication, but on exploration, we could find a communication with the small bowel. So you can see I'm pointing at the small bowel, the site of fistula. So that short segment of the small bowel was resected along with all the IPOM mesh and the onlay mesh which was there. And to close it up, we had to do an anterior component separation. You can see the edge of the external oblique. To achieve a tension-free midline closure. Diagnosis of underlying problem. Well, clinical examination, ultrasound, pus culture sensitivities are routine. But to identify the magnitude of the problem, we need a CT scan, which will exactly define what is the extent of collection, where the mesh is, what was the size of the defect, if there is any associated muscle atrophy or anything. So a CT scan gives us a lot of information to plan the next procedure. Most of the time, the cultures will be Staph aureus, and only 10% of the time, some other bacteria may crop up. So the initial, everyone tries to do the salvage. So if there is a seroma, it should not be disturbed unless it's too bothering or persisting for more than 3 months. But once infection has set in, it's difficult to salvage, but still a trial of antibiotic, debridement and drainage, negative pressure, wound therapy have shown some promising results. Macroprolus polypropylene may be salvageable, but most of the other type of mesh have failed in long term. Now, this is one publication from the Eric Pulley group. So they have tried salvaging some of their cases, and if we see that the management of these cases, it depends on use of antibiotic depending on the culture sensitivity, multiple debridement and drainage. Some of them had partial mesh excision, and negative pressure wound therapy was the one major thing which was introduced, and they show that they could salvage certain percentage of their infection with use of negative pressure wound therapy. These are the pictures from their publications, which shows that use of negative pressure suction therapy and delayed primary closure, drainage, debridement, which has to be obviously multiple times. And once gradually the healthy granulation comes, the skin can be closed. This is one paper which came up recently, and they have, in addition to negative therapy, they have used a system called the Veraflow. Basically, this includes a saline irrigation of the cavity. So this type of cavity, if only VAC is applied, the duration of closure was reduced once they use that Veraflow system of irrigation of the cavity with saline. So basically that led to like flushing out of the debris and early generation of healthy granulation tissue over the macroporous mesh. And if we look at this algorithm of management of mesh infection, well, after trying all the salvage therapies, if you have succeeded, well and good. But what if you fail? If you fail, then you are left with the two choices of either a mesh excision along with a single stage abdominal hernia repair or a stage procedure. So both have their pros and cons. Single stage approach is when you have done with your mesh removal and your debridement, you go ahead and repair the hernia with a biological mesh. So the problem with this approach is, well, we know all that biologicals are costly, and they have also noted that 50% of their case had infection. But then the advantage is that patient is spared of a second surgery. And most of those complications, which wound complications which developed, were could be managed on office-based treatment or minor procedures. While if you choose the staged procedure, you have not repaired the hernia, so patient is definitely bound to have a hernia recurrence, and patient is bound to have a second surgery, which definitely is not going to be an easy one. So these are the various biological meshes available. We don't have much of experience in biological because of the prohibitive cost and availability. If we look into the details, most of them are either human dermis or porcine dermis derived. Some are from porcine intestinal submucosa and few from bovine pericardium. Next is biosynthetic mesh. These are basically absorbable meshes. So mostly we level them as, say, Vicryl mesh or the Bio-A mesh, which usually resolves by 6 months. The advantage is that it is cheaper than the biological and can be used in an infected setting or a contaminated setting. The next material which has come is the Phasix, which is poly-4-hydroxybutyrate. And this also gets absorbed within 6 months. So they have come up with a newer Phasix ST, which is again a mix up of polyglycolic acid, carboxymethyl cellulose, and few other things. And usually it is resolved after 12 to 18 months. So in this kind of scenarios, this biosynthetic processes can be used. Now, this is an interesting study which involves the heavyweights in hernia surgery like Eric Pole, Igor Belyansky, Yuri Nevitsky. And mind it, this is regarding contaminated hernia and not infected hernia I'm speaking about. And they have shown that they supported the use of synthetic mesh, there is macroporous polypropylene, in a contaminated field was more appealing than the use of a biological mesh, because there is no definite advantage of using a biological mesh in a contaminated setting. Now, a few pictures. This is a onlay repair which was done 3 months back and has come to us with multiple discharging sinus. This is a TAP procedure which was done 2 months back and now comes with pulse discharge. This is an interesting case. TAP procedure was done 4 years back, and he presented to us with a lump in the left iliac fossa. And the approach is a bit different from the routine approach. So here what we have done is, you can see in the CT scan, it's a large lapillated cavity. So what we did is we explored the cavity directly. Directly a fiber microcar was pushed inside and the content was sucked. And then when we peeped inside the cavity with a camera, we can see a polyester mesh lying there. And then further ports were placed under guidance through this cavity. and the cavity was explored without entering the peritoneum or putting a large incision outside. So this cavity was nicely irrigated, and then under vision, the mesh was excised. So one should be careful while excising this type of mesh. Many a times it will easily come out, but sometimes if the fixation has been done with a tracker or suture, those fixation areas may be stuck, and you have to use a scissor to get rid of those parts. This is one interesting case which IPOM was done 5 years back, and she presented with a lump in the intraumbilical region. She was referred as a case of query mesenteric cyst or hydatid cyst. I mean, the radiologist level even presence of laminating membrane inside the cyst. Actually, then we proceeded with a diglap, and after adhesiolysis, the cyst was seen to be attached to the wall, and there was no communication with the bowel. Now an incision was put from outside and a 10 mm trocar was put inside the cavity, and material was sucked out. In case it is a hydrated or something, at least there won't be any spillage. Next, the cavity was scoped, and we could see a large piece of this peritex mesh, because this is the polyester after the absorbable bit is absorbed. This is the polyester mesh which is left behind, and you can see the multiple tackers and the transfixation sutures. So similarly, two other ports were placed, and then the mesh was taken out. The cavity was nicely irrigated, and a Romovac suction drain was kept after extraction of all the trackers. And this is one more case of IPOM, which was done 1 year back. And he came with, he was treated for antibiotic for almost past 1 year on and off by the operating surgeon. Then he came to us, and this, it showed a collection, and on exploring the cavity, you can see pus and all. And the unincorporated IPOM mesh could be seen inside the cavity. So most of the times, this attackers and mesh is floating inside the cavity, but at times, places of transfixation and all those areas, you need to just do a sharp, bit of sharp dissection to separate the mesh. Now, this is the mesh infection algorithm suggested by Todd Henniford and their group. So if there is a presence of fistula, there is no question of salvage, and they go for excision of the mesh. If the patient is a smoker, again, goes for excision of mesh. Now, depending on the type of the mesh, what they have noted is it's only the macroporous polypropylene mesh which are not infected by MRSA were the one which they could salvage. Rest, most of the other landed up in removal of the mesh. Again, this is from Eric Pelli group, and they also noted similarly that salvage attempts were undertaken primarily in patients with retromuscular macroporous polypropylene, and most of the other types have failed in long term. Now, this to end, there's a few interesting cases. This is one case wherein there is a mesh eroding into the bladder in a TAPP case done 2 years back. And this is a cystoscopy showing the mesh has eroded inside the bladder. So laparoscopy was done, and then the bladder was opened, so filled up and then opened, and we could see the entire mesh has migrated inside and is lying inside the bladder. Next, another interesting case is here. The tap was done 1 year back, and the mesh has eroded into the sigmoid colon. The sigmoidoscopy, you can see the mesh inside the colon. And similarly, the area was explored, and then the patient had to undergo a limited resection of the sigmoid colon. So one has to ensure that the entire foreign material is taken out, because if a portion of it is left behind, there is chances that it may again lead to some kind of a collection and a fistula developing later on. So one has to ensure that the entire mesh is grabbed and brought, and it should be extracted properly to prevent spread of infection. Someone has well said that it is always better to prepare and prevent than to repair and prevent. So all precautions should be taken before taking up a challenging case. And I thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. Thank you for your patient listening.
Thank you, Dr. Pinnock.
Thank you.
So thank you, Pinnock, sir. I think all the three speakers and the topics were so interesting. I'm sure the audience must have really enjoyed your talk. Now it's time for us to move on with our panel discussion for today. Before going on to the panel discussion, I would quickly like to introduce Dr. Deepak Subramanyam, because he's a moderator of today's session, but due to some emergency, sir was not there at the start. I'm really happy that, sir, you could join us today in spite of having emergency. Thank you so much for that. To introduce sir is a senior consultant and clinical lead of Department of General Surgery, Laparoscopic and Bariatric Surgery at MGM Healthcare, Chennai. Sir has a rich experience of over 12 years in the field of laparoscopic, general, GI and bariatric surgery. He has also performed more than 2,000 basic and advanced laparoscopic surgeries. Sir is a passionate speaker and an orator. And I think with this, I would hand over to sir for the panel discussion. Over to you, sir.
Thanks, Amrita, for the introduction. They're running behind schedule. So I'll quickly introduce the panelists. We have four eminent panelists for this panel discussion. We have Professor C.D. Narayanan, who's a professor of surgery from Sri Ramchandra Medical College. We have Dr. Ashvelu, surgeon, for consultant surgeon from Ashwin Hospitals, Coimbatore. We have Dr. Bharat Kumar from GEM Hospital, Coimbatore. And from MGM Healthcare, Chennai. Is this audible?
Yeah, it's now
better.
Now,
audio.
Yeah,
but now it's
better.
Yeah. Now it's okay. Better. Now it's okay.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks. So I'll ask a specific question to a panelist, and they can give it to me a quick answer, say within 30 seconds to 1 minute for each question. Okay. So I'll move ahead with the first case. So I'll go ahead with the first question to Dr. Bharat Kumar from GEM Hospital. This is a patient who's come from abroad. He's known to your hospital chairman and is his close friend. He wants laparoscopic hernia repair. He's undergone a post-op. He's undergone a radical prostatectomy, open radical prostatectomy 3 years back. He's come with a bilateral inguinal hernia. Now I want you to tell me clearly, what would be the steps that you would think? Of course, we will try and explain to the patient that we might want to do another methods and stuff, but this patient's come for laparoscopy. So what would be the steps during the procedure that you would consider key or critical before you venture upon the surgery? Would you do a DAPP or a DEP on this patient?
Thank you, sir. As a routine, we always go for a TEP in this scenario. So even with the previous cars, we used to go for TEP whenever the option is good for us, because we used to train more in TEPs, even with previous cars. The only bad scenario in this patient, it's a lower abdominal surgery. And apart from the scar, you expect a dense adherence of a bladder, it will be there. So the careful meticulous dissection will always pave the way, and we always go with a TEP rather than a TAPP.
Okay. And do you anticipate any problems because of the previous radical prostatectomy, especially?
Yes, sir. Whenever you go for pelvic dissection, so you'll be having an issues moving the bladder a little bit down.
Yeah.
So it is better to always take the posterior rectusial fascia along with the bladder down and bear the muscle in this scenario.
Perfect. So that was the main reason why I put this scenario. Thanks, Dr. Bharat, for that.
Thank you, sir.
So I'll move on to the second case. This would be, I would ask Dr. Professor C.D. Narayanan. This is a patient who's having an inguinoscrotal swelling on the right side. Right side already, an open hernioplasty was done 8 years back, after which 6 years later from there, he underwent a bilateral TEP. Now, he's come back with a right-sided inguinoscrotal swelling. Sir, if you can tell us what would be your approach from the time of clinical examination, investigations, following which, how would you manage this patient?
So he's had a recurrent hernia, which he's had a right open hernioplasty. Is that right?
So two times he's had on the right side, sir. Sorry? Two times he's had on the right side. Initially, okay. It was a right Lichtenstein open hernia.
He's had it for three times or two times?
Sir, on the right side, he's had it two times, sir. Now he's come with a right side inguinoscrotal swelling. The first surgery was a Lichtenstein repair, after which he had a TEP repair. Now it's 2 years following the TEP repair.
If somebody is having a recurrence, we need to find out what exactly. Is it a patient factor? Is it a technical fault? Most often it's a patient factor in terms of collagen deficiencies, or patient might be a smoker, or is occupational hazard where it's not really, you know, tending, lifting weights in the proper manner. So we need to find out what exactly is the pre-op factor which is giving rise to the recurrence.
So if it's I can specifically ask you, what specific investigations you would ask for this particular patient other than your routine hernia investigations, what would you ask?
I presume he's a male. So most men, we need to find out what his urinary symptoms are, how much of post-void residual urine is, what is the BMI calculation, other risk factors of obesity, and about his occupation, whether he's lifting heavy weights in his thing. So all the predisposing factors for a hernia, as well as anything which is predisposing to his collagen metabolism, which is affecting him, we need to investigate, because he's had twice recurrence with a proper repair done, then it's unlikely that it is a technical fault. It's likely to be a patient-related factor.
What would your choice of procedure be, sir, assuming all the patient factors are
normally fine? The saying is, if you have an open repair and a recurrence, you go for lap, and when you have a lap recurrence, you go for open. This gentleman apparently has had both an open repair and a lap repair, which gives me less choice, and I have to decide. So in this patient, probably I would go in for a TAPP and you know, put in a big prosthesis to cover all the orifices.
What would you do with the previous mesh, sir, in the TEP plane? That is that which you will encounter.
The previous mesh would have got integrated into tissues where you can't separate it unless a mesh has been infected. Most often they integrate. And if it's really not interfering with your plane of dissection, you just keep the tissues away, dissect in a different plane. Especially near the vessels, you need to be very careful. Sometimes it can be densely adherent, considering the patient has had a bilateral TEP repair. And once you clear the neural and the vascular tissues, you're safe to put in a prosthesis, cover all orifices, secure it in place, and I think that should hold good.
Thank you, sir. So I'll move on to the next case. Dr. Ashwin, I would want you to take this case. This is a post-op day 30 for a bilateral TEP done. Patient is having a right inguinal swelling and he's having a high-grade fever for the last 4 to 5 days. How would you approach this patient? And please go ahead with this.
So swelling, I think, is quite commonly seroma as a common presentation which we see. So as soon as I see a swelling, I wouldn't be too concerned. I would just work him up for the fever and try to find out the reason for the fever.
It's a tender swelling. It's not just a swelling.
Yeah, still I would rule out, you know, medical causes and treat him with the antibiotics and conservative management first. Because within 30 days, I don't expect a frank infection causing so much of issues for a patient secondary to a mesh.
Would there be a role for ultrasound at this point, Dr. Ashwin?
No, ultrasound is going to show me a swelling, but I don't think they'll be able to characterize well whether any pus or any air is seen inside that. It would be quite difficult. So like I told you, in addition to the conservative management, if it doesn't improve, then CT is probably what I would be looking at.
Right. So in your practice, Dr. Ashwin, when would you prefer to put in a needle and aspirate the seroma at any point of time, or what is the threshold you will wait for till you act upon it?
So this patient, like I said, treated conservatively, not improved, and the only symptoms related to the inguinal region swelling is persistent. then CT is the investigation I would do. If I see a collection and I don't see the mesh, you know, quite flat, it's floating around, crumpled, and there are features of an abscess, you see some air into the cavity, then that is probably the time where I would think about just aspirating the fluid under aseptic precautions and sending it and for culture, ruling out for infection and all that.
In post-op swellings like this, when do you think you can consider an infection in these patients?
A mesh infection.
I should be.
So generally, it's a 3-month period, what I see in my practice and in my experience, but it could vary from individual to individual. One month, I would still consider it to be a too short a period of
time. Too short a period. Perfect. Thanks, Ashwin. Thank you. So this is Dr. Pari. For Dr. Pari, patients plan for a bilateral lapping venous hernioplasty. You are primarily a TAPP surgeon. You are still in the learning curve. So you started off with TAPP. Most of us have done that way. There is some history of lap surgery. Details are not known. Clearly, the port scars are not visible. Varies, you tried. You're not able to show. You're not sure if it's gone inside. So you do an open access. You find that there is an adhesions on entering in. And you see a bowel rent from the varies. Now, you are the primary surgeon. You are, say, in a rural place. How would you approach this? What would you do next?
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. From the outside, I like to thank Chennai Hernia Society. Since I'm in the learning curve, since there are a lot of young surgeons are here, since I'm in learning curve, once I see a bowel rent, what I suggest is if you are capable of repairing it, if it's a bigger rent, you can take a stitch and then come out safely. That's the best thing you can do. Suppose you are still in the learning curve, young surgeon, you don't know what to do, make a small incision, take the viscera out, suture it, put it back, explain to the patient, don't plan for any primary repair of the hernia. This is for a young surgeon.
So that's okay, so you will not go ahead with the hernia at that point, is that what
for the beginners, suppose if I'm a scenario, what I'll do is there are two options I can think of. Either I in primary close the defect and go for an open hernia repair safely, or approach for a TEP approach.
That's one question which I wanted to ask. I want the faculty, Dr. Pinnock or Dr. Prem, Naveen, or any of the other three panelists, how many of you in this case will go for an open hernioplasty? How many of you in this case will go for a primary laparoscopic repair after 10 to 12 days? Each one of you can take the turns and answer. I'll start off with Dr. Ashwin maybe. What would you do, Ashwin?
So I would generally try to defer the procedure for a later period to be more safe.
Perfect. Dr. Bharat?
Sir, if the contamination is less, only weed is, it is not puncturing more. So I used to suture, then I'll go for a primary repair.
If primary the contamination repair is by more, laparoscopy?
Yes, sir. If the contamination is more, there is extravasation of fluid from the viscera, I used to suture it and it used to come out. I'll go after 2 weeks.
Dr. Professor Narayanan?
Yeah, it all depends on the degree of contamination. If there is less contamination,
I'll make it quick and short. It's a colonic contamination. Okay.
Then I would defer the surgery to a later date, deal with this primary problem which I have created, talk to the patient that this has happened. I wouldn't like to put a mesh and ask them to come at a later date.
You would not do an open repair also. Is that correct, sir?
Not really. We're having an additional problem which was not intended, right?
Okay. Dr. Pinnock?
Yeah, I think if it's a colon, then obviously no one would venture. But if it's a small bowel with without contamination, just the varices has gone inside, even you can suture and go ahead with TAPP also. I have seen that also. And with macroprolapse polypropylene meshes being placed right during the surgery for creation after creation of colostomy, or multiple evidences are there of feasibility of placing a macroporous mesh in clean contaminated or contaminated scenarios. So it's you have to come out and discuss with the patient's attendant that this is the situation. We can just stop the surgery then and there, and you have to undergo the repair some other day. Or you can take a very minimal risk of mesh infection, which is, can't say how much percentage exactly, but it's a very minimal chance. And if you go ahead and do a TAPP, I think that's also a viable option if it's a small bowel without In fact, a serious needle injury, your suturing also will be like, you don't, it won't be a big rent or something to put two or three sutures. It will be just a inverting suture.
Thanks, Dr. Pinnock. I think, yeah, as you rightly said, prevention of mesh infection would be the most ideal here. And going in at a later case, later time would be better. This question, I'll put it to Dr. Ashwin. This is an infraumbilical hernia with divarication of recti. Previous history of two normal vaginal deliveries. Size of the defect is 3 to 5 centimeters. Patients come for laparoscopy, procedure of choice. And where would you put your ports, Dr. Ashwin?
So this would be a laparoscopic preperitoneal repair, which would be my primary choice, something like a TAPP repair. The ports would be camera port in the epigastric region, right and left subcostal working ports.
Okay. And you would do the divarication, closure of the defect, and then put a mesh in the TAPP plane. That's exactly what you want.
Yeah, right? I would like to see how significant the divarication is, because divarication, it might have a supraumbilical component as well. So if I need to repair both, then I might have to change my plan or place my ports accordingly.
If you have, that's why I asked about the ports exactly. So this, assuming you're looking at a divarication in the lower midline, is that what you're talking about?
So yeah. So if it's only infraumbilical, the port which I mentioned is good enough.
If yes. No. Hernia, the hernia is infraumbilical, but the divarication is from the ziphy to the, it's complete.
Yes. Okay. So then I would place a few ports in the lower abdomen, correct the divarication, place the mesh, mm-hmm. same plan, using the superior ports and close the flap which is raised as well.
The other three panelists, what would be your procedure of choice, Dr. Pari?
Same thing as Ashwin told, we can start as a TAPP approach.
TAPP, you mean?
Yeah, TAPP, yeah. Mm-hmm. We can do TAPP. But since okay. it's infraumbilical, I can plan as a TEP also. It's an ERPR okay. technique.
ETEP, you mean?
Yeah, ETEP technique.
But the divarication part?
Sir, please. I want to differ here. If there is a significant divarication, a TAPP may not offer much of a guidance for the divarication part. Placement of mesh for the umbilical hernia might be useful. But if you need to correct the divarication, probably an endo RS might be a better procedure for me rather than a TAPP. If there is no divarication and only an umbilical hernia, I agree with the TAPP. But if there is significant divarication, I think an endo RS for a 5 centimeter defect might be warranted. Yeah.
Okay. Dr. Bharat, what would the GEM hospital approach be in this?
We used to go for having two approaches. One, we directly go for ETEP and create a plane all around. Then we'll do the plication and we'll keep a bigger mesh. So right. come out. The second thing is we just put a epigastric port and correct the hernia repair and along with the divarication repair and put a lateral port also, one or two extra ports to keep the mesh too much up, to keep a bigger mesh.
Okay.
Both the approaches can be done, EPOM, IPOM and ETEP.
Sure, thanks. Okay, so I'll go with Professor C.D. Narayanan here. 4 years back, an IPOM plus has been done. Now he has a recurrence. What would the procedure of choice be? Let's quick the steps. Let's skip the steps and go for the procedure alone.
No procedure. You've not told me about BMI, diabetes, why recurrence, where is the defect, multiple
okay, sir.
Defects, what is the divarication?
This question was not for you. By mistake, I asked you. But any which ways, if anybody else would have not asked me these questions. But anyway.
What I'm thinking is, if there is a recurrence, we need to find out why yes. is there recurrence. And
this was an IPOM plus done for an umbilical hernia. Again, on the same site, there is a recurrence. The size of the defect now is about 3 to 4 centimeters. And BMI is this is a perfectly normal lady. She's completed family and she's 40 years old.
There's no divarication, no other defects.
No divarication, nothing, sir. What would be your procedure of choice?
Here again, this again can be tackled with an endo-RS.
Endo-RS.
Or whatever you call it. Yeah,
my mistake to have asked you this question, sir. Sorry. okay, I'll go with Dr. Bharat here. You have a chronic non-healing sinus from the previous history of IPOM done. This non-healing sinus is just lateral to the umbilicus. IPOM was done 1 year back. I want you to tell me the next step of approach, not the procedure and other things. even from your investigation and the line of management that you're going to do with this.
For a non-chronic, non-healing sinus, we used to take a culture, which first we rule out the tuberculosis, then we'll do a sinogram and also a CT abdomen. We'll look for any collections inside. If there is any collection inside, we used to just check the healing tendency of the mesh, whether it is, so there is a seroma, what about the capacity of the wall clearance, then we'll just go for a intra-abdominal approach. We'll just remove the mesh, clear the sinus, and take out the sinus tract also.
Okay.
If there is any cavity, if there is any pus or cavity, we'll try to take out the mesh. Right. And also the we have to just do a sinus tract excision also. If there is only a sinus tract, there is no collection, the mesh is intact, we just excise the sinus tract and we'll just do the dressing and I'll wait for the healing purposes.
Right. If you're removing the mesh, you find that you have to remove the mesh. And you do a primary, do you do a primary repair and to put the mesh at a later point? What is your approach there? Would you be able to tell the audience?
That's what, sir. If we just go, already there will be a NIPOM plus. We already sutured the defect. We just go intra-abdominally again. We'll just take out the mesh. I don't think there will be any defects again.
Okay.
We'll just take out the mesh. We'll the clear point the cavity.
Here is, the point here is that you don't need to put a mesh at that point, correct?
Yes, sir.
Thanks. This is Dr. Pari. I'll give you a scenario. This is a 42-year-old gentleman, small symptomatic umbilical hernia, IPOM plus done. First POD, he develops abdominal distension. And this would be the CT that you're seeing in this patient. Okay. Just watch the CT. It's a 20-30 second one. IPOM plus done 1 day back. Abdominal distension. What is running through your mind, Pari, as you see the CT? If you can just tell us, that will be great so we can save time.
I'm trying to place, find where the mesh are. I can see some tackers here and there.
Yeah.
I can see the bowel are close to the
What tackers. Would run in your mind on the first post-op day following an IPOM plus? Are you looking?
So probably this is a reaction to the mesh. Patient has some paralytic ileus. First thing is I want to rule out paralytic ileus.
Okay.
Most of the patients, what happens, IPOM, because the tackers can produce severe pain. Some patients have intolerable pain. So because of that, they'll try to keep the intra-abdominal muscle tight. They have some paralytic ileus. So here I can see multiple tackers.
Yeah.
And then I can see the distended bowel loop, which are close to the...
So let's say paralytic ileus. I want to ask the panelists, how many of you will do a CT on the first post-op day if you develop an abdominal distension? What would be your approach in these patients? Professor Narayanan, please.
It all depends who the primary surgeon is.
Yeah, I am the primary surgeon. Today, tomorrow morning, I'm calling you saying I have abdominal distension.
Normally, on POD1, you wouldn't want to do a CT scan because you don't suspect anything on POD1. If you have a recording of your video, best thing is to go back and review your video and see if a straightforward umbilical hernia with IPOM attacking, practically nothing can go wrong. So unlikely that you're expecting any bowel pathology which is going to happen. So I wouldn't do a CT at all in the first place or look at the CT.
Dr. Ashwin?
So, CT, generally I wouldn't do for an abdomen distension on the first day. Okay. Even though if you suspect a bowel injury, the common presentation would be the abdomen would look quite soft. There won't be any frank distension. It'll be more of other signs like tachycardia, fever, unexplained pain. All those are the concerning warning signs which I would be wary about, most often on the second or third day. So first off, I wouldn't do a CT.
Okay. Dr. Bharat, this is a case for you. Post-op LSCS incisional hernia, BMI 39, reducible, 35-year-old, straightforward 4 into 5 centimeter defect, midline in the lower segments, cesarean scar. Approach?
Sir, hence the BMI is quite a bit high. I counsel the patient for a bariatric surgery combined with hernia repair.
Okay, I'll want to pause you there. I'll come back to you, Dr. Bharat. Professor Narayanan, your approach in this?
I am a bariatric surgeon, so really I wouldn't know about that.
But what would you do, sir? You are a bariatric. Would you send it to a bariatric surgeon who can combine and do, or would you do a bariatric first and then time for
No, as if this incision line is symptomatic, it's a midline defect, 4 into 5 centimeters. I would go for a, you know, IPOM with a partial mesh, dissect the bladder and the peritoneum, and tuck a mesh in right up to the pubis, and then the intraperitoneal part and use packers and fix it over sutures.
You wouldn't do anything for the BMI, sir.
For the defect.
You wouldn't do anything for the BMI, sir.
BMI probably later on in the patient. See, I'm basically an anti-bariatric surgeon. I don't believe in the concept of bariatric surgery because I feel it's not physiological. But this forum, probably we should not discuss that. I think all of your bariatric surgeons, there's 5 of you will be ready to bounce on me. But yes, there are papers which say, actually, there's a topic coming on AWR which combines, do we do a hernia surgery at the same time as bariatric?
That's tomorrow evening, yes.
Probably it's a good topic to discuss tomorrow. I'll watch it and then I'll decide what to do with this case.
Ashwin, what would you do with this patient, Ashwin?
So I would counsel the patient for a weight loss program and see if they can lose around 10 to 15% of their body weight right now. And if there are no other metabolic symptoms for the patient, I think that is pretty much good enough. And that would be okay for me to think about hernia repair after the weight loss.
So anything the panelists want to tell the audience here as takeaway points for troubleshooting, please. I'll start off with Dr. Pari and then we'll move on with the other three panelists and then we can close the session.
Yeah, so all of us emphasize on proper history of the patient is very important before jumping into surgery. And you have to prefix what surgery you're going to do. If you're planning for a TIP or TAP or IPOM plus whatever, you have to have an idea before going in. You can't make idea after entering the theater. Don't make a choice. So if you have a prefix plan, then it will work out easily. And as Dr. Prem sir has emphasized and Naveen sir emphasized, you have to make sure where you're going to put the port placement. Port placement is utmost important. Suppose your young surgeons are watching TIP surgery, the first port is the main thing. If you put the first port, 80% of the troubleshooters are gone. TIP. So like that, every surgery has a critical steps. So if you find out what the critical steps and do those critical steps, and everything will be taken care of.
Professor Narayanan?
Yeah, I think I'm on the sunset of my career, probably I can say that. What is most important is hernia is evolving so rapidly. Every day is changing. When I was a PG student, we read textbooks to keep abreast with what is going on. But today with online and platforms and so many groups, every day is changing. For the last, say, 2 weeks, I've learned on biomechanics, which is script value and how to calculate mesh, which is so taxing on my brain. And then we are going to have talks on bariatric and AWR. So, and I think the future is going to be robotics. The next generation, considering the coronavirus pandemic, should take up robotics in a big way, and the lab will eventually fade out. I'm fortunate that I've been through open surgery, went into lab, and maybe might visit robotic. But the future, I think strongly, I predict robotics and biomechanics are going to play a major role in hernia reconstruction. The younger generation should look ahead of what is going on today, rather than learn lap and then correct your mistakes and so on.
Thank you, sir. You're always part of the younger generation you're talking about. Dr. Bharat, your thoughts, please.
Sir, to all the beginners and the budding surgeons, I used to tell, just go for a TAPP, choose a very small case. So uncomplicated hernias, first try TAPP, because in the literature also it is mentioned that a TAPP is a very good operation. It has a both better outcome. Once you just go for a TAPP, then slowly you just start doing IPOM also. So beginner will be the IPOM, I agree. But after the TAPP, only you just go for TEP. So then you just go for complicated cases. That is my advice.
Thanks. Dr. Ashwin?
So most of the infections which we see is due to poor sterility. So never compromise on sterility. Every procedure has its own set of complications. So you have to be familiar with them so that you can easily tackle them and pick it up at the earliest point. One small point about these injuries regarding the trocar and the varus. Whenever you have an injury, make sure you check the posterior wall as well. A lot of the times it will be a through and through injury, anterior and posterior wall. So that's it. Thank you.
So thanks. Thanks, everyone. That was a wonderful discussion. I want to thank all the panelists, the faculty, Dr. Pinak, Dr. Prem Kumar Balachander, Dr. Naveen Alexander for giving us a great lecture today. And thank you once again to all the participants for taking their time out on a weekday in the evening to come out listen to us. I want to thank the Merrill Academy and the team that is behind this for giving us this opportunity on behalf of Chennai Hernia Society. I just want to make a quick announcement that our next meeting of Chennai Hernia Society will be in combination with Tamil Nadu Bariatric Club, which is we are trying to schedule it on the October 31st. And we are trying to see if we can have a physical meeting in Chennai. So I request and invite all of you here to please join us for the meeting. More details we'll share shortly in our Facebook page and also in the Tamil Nadu Bariatric Club WhatsApp page. So thank you so much. Over to the Merrill team and to go ahead.
Thank you very much, Deepak sir. And thank you all the panelists. I would now like to invite Mr. Chintan Gajjar, our sales and marketing manager for Advance Portfolio. So over to you, Chintan sir, to give a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Amrita. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yeah, so hello, good evening, respected faculties and delegates. It's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this webinar. My name is Chintan Gajjar on behalf of Merrill Endosurgery team and Merrill Academy. Extend a very heartly vote of thanks to the delegates first for joining us today for an excellent hernia surgery webinar. I would like to extend a special thanks to Chennai Hernia Society for giving us an opportunity to organize this wonderful event jointly. I also wish to express my gratitude to all respected speakers, panelists, and moderator today who took out valuable time of their busy schedule, gracing your important work and sharing knowledge on troubleshooting in hernia surgeries. All are inspired by your great experience. Thank you. At last, I thank and congratulate Ms. Amrita Jangam and entire Merrill team for wonderful coordination, making this event successful. So once again, thank you all participants for joining us today. Stay safe and take care. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, guys. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.